Funding for A Conversation with Wink Martindale was provided by
Mid-America Apartment Communities, an apartment-only real estate investment trust serving the Southeast and South Central United States. On the web at maac.net. Mid-America Apartment Communities, creating great places to live.
And by the WKNO Partners in Excellence Fund, committed to presenting quality programming. And also by members like you. Thank you.
He hails from Jackson, Tennessee, and made his TV debut in Memphis as a teenager.
It's going to be the number one record in the country in 2 short weeks.
In his more than 50 years on television, he's hosted at least 19 different shows, including Top 10 Dance Party and Tic Tac Dough. Join me, Bonnie Perkins, as we sit down now for A Conversation with Wink Martindale.
Hi, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, Bonnie.
Let's start out talking about your childhood right here in the Mid-South. You grew up very close to here, didn't you?
Yeah, Jackson, Tennessee. You can do a little arithmetic. I was born in 1933, and right out of high school, I always wanted to be in radio. So I was lucky in that I always knew what I wanted to do with my life. I never had to sit around and say, oh, gosh, what am I going to do for a living? And so I went right into radio at the age of 17 years old in a local radio station in Jackson, and that's what got me started.
Now, I understand that even before you were in radio, you were practicing back in your bedroom trying to talk like an announcer.
Yeah. My brothers thought I was kind of crazy, but my mother thought I was kind of smart because she knew that I wanted to be a radio announcer. That was before the term disc jockey came in. So I used to tear pages out of Life magazine. My dad's boss gave us a subscription to Life at Christmas every year. So I kept up with current events, pretended I was doing the news, tear pages out of the magazine, and pretended to do commercials, ad-libbing around those. So it gave me the ability, somewhat, to ad-lib and to also read well. So I've always been a good reader and hopefully a fair ad-libber, you know, in the world of radio, which is very important and helped me later in television.
Well, you were just a teenager at the time. How did you get that first lucky break to get actually started in radio?
I was only a child, just a mere child. My Sunday school teacher's name was Chick Wingate, and he happened to be the manager of one of the radio stations in Jackson. We had 3 radio stations. This was the smallest one, 250-watt tea kettle called WPLI, and the mayor of Jackson owned the station. Well, I kept bugging Chick because he knew I wanted to be a radio announcer someday. And every time I'd see him, whether it's Sunday school or wherever on the streets of Jackson, I'd say, Chick, when are you going to give me an audition? I didn't know what audition meant, but I looked it up one day. I said, that's what I want, an audition. So one night I was sitting on the railing of the First National Bank building in downtown Jackson. And I was sitting there with Charlie Pate and Dickie Bear, 2 good friends of mine. And up pulls this little Henry J, little old Henry J, 1951. They've long since gone by the by. No more Henry J. cars. But Chick gets out, and he's going up on the 4th floor of the bank building where the radio station was, small radio station. I said, Chick, when are you going to give me a... He says, now, come on. So he grabs my arm, and he takes me up on the elevator, and he sits me down in front of a microphone, rips some news copy off the machine, gives me a couple of commercials, and I read all of this. And I do it like it's fallen off a log because I've been practicing in the back bedroom all those years. And I think he was a little bit shocked. He said, not bad. He said, you come down here tomorrow after you get out of school. We'll meet the mayor, Mayor George Smith, who owned the station. And he said, we'll see what he says. So I did that. Came down the next day, did the same thing, went through the whole routine again, read the news copy, read the commercials. And George Smith, the mayor, said, you got a job, son. He said, when can you start? I said, how about now? They put me on the air that day at 6 o'clock. I did a Nolan's Kitty Shop commercial, 60 seconds. I called my mom to tell her, Mom, I'm going to be doing a Nolan's Kitty Shop commercial at 6 o'clock. Be sure you listen. She said, you're kidding. I said, no, I got the job. They're going to give me $25 a week. She couldn't believe it. She listened. When I got home, I still live with my mom and dad. You know, I got home about 6:30. I said, you hear me? She said, that wasn't you. You know, you never sound like, you know. She said, that was, I said, yes, it was, Mother. The Nolan's commercial, I said, yes, that was me. She said, well, that's pretty good. I said, well, thank you, Mother.
And how old were you?
I was 17 years old. I was just before graduating. This was about May, and graduation was in June. So it was just before I graduated from high school. And that's the way my radio career started. And I stayed in at that station, did play-by-play football and basketball, because I knew everybody on the football and basketball team. And then I was there for a few months, and then WTJS, the next largest station, 1,000 Water, you know, wanted to hire me. And so I went to work over there. I said goodbye, Chick, who had given me my start. And I was homesick for that station. I was only at WTJS for a few months. I went back to WPLI, to my $25.
To the little
one? $45 back to $25. Now, how smart was that? But anyway, everything worked
out.
That's
the last time in your career you went from a bigger
That was the last time I ever went up to down again. And then I went to WDXI, which was a 5,000-watt station. So when I went from WPLI to WTJS, back to WPLI to WDXI, one Sunday afternoon, after being at DXI for about a year, I realized it was time for me to make an audition. So I came down and surreptitiously, you understand, on a Sunday afternoon when the management wasn't there, I did an audition, read news, commercials and all, about a 30-minute audition, which I still have, by the way, which I put on a disc, an acetate, and I mailed it to Gordon Lawhead, who was program director at that time, the late Gordon Lawhead, at WHBQ Radio. And I heard back from him, and I figured, well, I'll either hear from him in a few months or I'll never hear from him. He got back to me in about 3 weeks and invited me over for a meeting to talk about a possible job at WHBQ Radio. And I was very young, you know, still like 19 years old. And I got my sister drove over with me. Because I was mortified, the idea of driving in Memphis, because I was a Jackson, Tennessee boy. To me, Memphis was like going to New York or, you know, to Nashville or St. Louis. And she drove me over. We went to WHBQ, which was on the mezzanine floor of the old Chiska Hotel on South Main Street. And I met Gordon Lawhead, and I met Bill Grumbles, who was station manager, and the late John Cleggern, who was the overall boss of everybody, and everybody was so nice, and I got hired on the spot. And I came back to Jackson just, you know, 10 feet off the ground. I was there for about, I worked, I think, 2 weeks, gave him 2 weeks' notice. And I moved to Memphis, made the big move, and never looked back, and got to do Clock Watchers, became assistant program director in time, music librarian, I did it all. I swept out the station at night, did all those things you do when you're, you know, really just getting started. Even though it was Memphis, I swept out the station when need be. And it just, it was one of the most enjoyable, Bonnie, it was one of the most enjoyable and wonderful times of my career. And I look back on it now and I still, it was just like yesterday, you know, I still remember the people I worked with, their first names, their last names, what they did, how many kids they had, you know, all the people I worked with. It was just a great experience. And then, of course, that's where I got into television.
You were in radio, so how did you make the leap from radio to television?
Well, I was at WHBQ Radio during the morning show and going to Memphis State, taking 16 hours. I was really busy. And to make myself busier, I think Bill Grumbles, the station manager, and Mr. John Cleggern didn't think I had enough to do. So when they went on the air with Channel 13 as a CBS affiliate, this was before WREG, which then was WREC television. When they first went on the air as a CBS affiliate, they obviously needed some local programming. And they came to me and said, how would you like to be on television? And I said, are you serious? I mean, it was my dream to be in radio. But now all of a sudden they're saying, would you like to be on the screen? You know, and I thought, this would really be cool. I will show them in Jackson and my brothers. So they gave me a television show with kids. It was called Wink Martindale of the Mars Patrol, and it was great experience for me. The seats were old metal airplane seats, like out of World War II fighter planes. And I would have a little thing up in the front here where it got ready to blast off. It was made out of a turntable, a record turntable, and I would turn that on, and they would start all these sound effects in the control room. This is when we got ready to blast off. This is after I interviewed all the kids, and we had our Bosco and Milk. And all of a sudden, you hear all of these sounds, you know, and the camera over my shoulder would zoom in on it. They had put lines on it, you know, so it looked spiraled in the middle. And we told the kids, you know, when we get ready to blast off, we always instructed them, and I would do this, You'd be sitting there and I'd do all this. And now we're ready to go. And everybody would move back like this, and the camera would move up so it looked like we were taking off. From the day it went on, it was extremely popular. And of course, I remember the first time I ever went to Goldsmith's it was the first time I'd ever done a personal appearance. And it was at the old Goldsmith's downtown. And there were kids lined up literally around the block. I mean, I was the first coming of Elvis, dear. Not really. I'm just kidding. I'd been doing radio, and all of a sudden I'm thrust into this television show, which is enormously popular. And these little kids think I'm, you know, the next coming. And it was so exciting. Nothing had ever happened to me like that, obviously. And all of a sudden, I went from somebody who couldn't play football to a radio personality that people knew and respected to a television star. And the kids loved me. And it was one of the most exciting periods in my life ever. All of a sudden, I was on television. I could walk down the street. I'd go into a restaurant. Wherever I went, people knew me. And it was a new experience. Later on, I would get to know that experience on a national scale. But it all started with Wink Martindale of the Mars Patrol. And again, I found out that I got lucky with Mars Patrol. And I got lucky with the Top 10 Dance Party. They became big hits in Memphis. And I thought, this is easy. But it's not always that easy. I was just lucky with those. There was that feeling in the early days of television, as I recall it, in Memphis, there was that feeling of camaraderie that we miss a lot now in the world of television. Everybody worked together. The staff was not that big. Everybody worked together. On Dance Party, for example, which was the show that I was mostly involved with in my career at Channel 13, everybody wanted to make it a good show. And if somebody completely unrelated to the show heard that a certain artist was going to be in town for 24 hours, he would come to me or call me at home or tell somebody. We'd try to get him to come in, and we didn't have videotape, so we had to kinescope an interview. Two of those, as a matter of fact, one with Pat Boone. He happened to be in town doing a show at the old Ellis Auditorium. And I knew Pat because we both had contracts with Dot Records. That's who I later made a million-selling record. Pat was a big star then. Had his own television show in New York, the Pat Boone Chevy Showroom. But came down to promote the Ellis Auditorium show the next day. And you might like to see what some of that was like. Here's Pat Boone.
Sure does. Well, Pat, tell us about your movie. Now, we know that you're going to have we're very cognizant of the fact you're going to have a show here on our station this fall and on ABC. Now, tell us about your movie. How was the experience of making a movie as compared to, well, we'll say TV?
I really enjoyed it. It was a vacation for me. You know, during school, I know you're acquainted with this, going to school yourself. When you go to school and trying to do things on the outside, it's a pretty hectic thing, and you're always thinking of eight things at once.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
When I was making the movie, they wouldn't let me think of anything except the movie, and I just concentrate on whatever scenes I was doing that day. When I got through with the day's shooting, they wanted me to go home and didn't even let me go out at night.
You didn't study any at all?
No, I wasn't in school. I was out, you know.
This is a very bad interviewer named Wink Martindale trying to be cool, talking to a big star named Pat Boone. I look at this sometime and I said, did I really say that? Is that the way I phrased that question? Is that the way I said, what brings you to Memphis, Pat?
Congratulations on this terrific show, boy.
Thank you very much, Pat Boone.
And then one day, when Neil Sedaka had his very first hit on RCA, he came to Memphis. And like Pat, we had to bring Neil in to the studio during the week.
How I'd like to look little book, the one that had the lock and key.
And he was very young, and so was I, and my interview skills weren't too cool, we might, to use the term loosely. But I just talked to him about his beginnings, because he was a Juilliard major, you know. For all those hit records that he enjoyed later, he was a Juilliard student and could play classical piano. But this is what he looked like, and this is what he sounded like in the beginning.
What brings you to Memphis, Tennessee? No doubt you're promoting a record.
That's true. I'm for the RCA people right now, and I'd like to add that they've been pretty great to us, going all out on the diary and giving us a real hand.
Well, that works both ways, you know. You've been pretty good to the RCA Victor people.
Well.
Sort of a vicious circle there. You're good to them, they're good to you. And I guess this is your first record on Victor, isn't it?
That's right. As far as singing goes, Wink, I've written quite a few other numbers before that, but this is the first one that I'm singing on with success.
I often say that everyone who lives in Memphis over a certain age, everyone without exception, has an Elvis story.
Yeah.
So you must have an Elvis story.
I think that my television interview in 1956 on Top Ten Dance Party was when Elvis came back from doing his first movie in Hollywood. And he was promoting a show. He wanted to promote this show at the Overton Park Shell that he was doing for charity. I think it was for the Cynthia Milk Fund. And so he came on my show. Dewey talked him into it, and I, because I had met him that night, and you know, at WHBQ, he wanted to promote this. He didn't. Colonel didn't want him to go on television anywhere doing anything, whether it was charitable or whatever, unless he was paid. Because we didn't have any budget. We didn't have, you know. So he came on the show. Colonel never did get over that. He never, in the early days, he didn't forgive me for that, because we never were close after that, because I think he held that against me. But Elvis came on the show, and I think that interview that day was the first, if not the first, one of the first couple of televised interviews that he ever did that was put on tape. Somebody suggested, we had a photographer in town in Memphis then. We didn't have videotape, so we couldn't video it. And Bob Zimmerman was his name, and he suggested, why don't you, this guy's getting pretty big, why don't you let me come in and I'll make a video of this. In other words, a kinescope, put it on 16 millimeter film, which is what we did. And I paid him, I don't know, it was $25 or $30 to come in that afternoon. He set up his camera in front of the jukebox where I always did my interviews. And that interview has been used on so many programs, network and otherwise, over the years. And unfortunately, I loaned that out, the master tape, my master copy, to someone. I never got it back, and I have the full interview on audio tape, but I only have a couple of minutes now that were gleaned from that interview. And if you'd like to see a little bit of it, he was promoting an appearance at the Overton Park Shell, but in it he showed me a ring that he had been given by Judy Spreckles of the Spreckles Sugar Empire. And he was going with her at that time for a couple of days, and she gave him a ring. And to show you on this interview, we only had one camera and we couldn't do a close-up, so when he holds it out and shows me the ring, we never really saw the ring close-up because we couldn't take a close-up. God, that still frightens me and bugs me to this day. But let's take a look at it.
And about this Judy Spreckles, that I've been getting a lot of publicity with Judy Spreckles.
Uh-huh.
I got started when Judy gave me a ring out in Las Vegas. She gave me this ring here. And, what ring there?
It is a pretty big ring, isn't it? Would you show it to us close up there?
Yeah, sure.
It's pretty big and beautiful ring, too.
Somebody started that she was wearing my ring and I was wearing her ring. We were wearing each other's rings.
That's the way it goes. How about the big show at Rustwood Park scheduled for July 4th? Bob Johnson, surely I know, wants us to mention that, and we want to mention it. I believe the proceeds from this show go to the Cynthia Milk Fund. Is that right, Elvis?
Yes, sir, that's right. And I'd like to say let's see, what would I like to say? I'd like to say that we have a diamond ring that we're going to have as a door prize. It's my initial ring. I've had it for some time, and it has 14 diamonds in it. And we're going to give it away at the door as a door prize.
I see.
And everything.
And all the proceeds from this particular show, this is July 4th at Rustwood Park. Elvis is going to be there. He's going to sing and play. His band will be there. Many other stars will be there, too. And we will certainly want you to watch Bob Johnson's column in the Memphis Press Cemetery. Watch all the publicity on it and get your tickets in advance. Elvis Presley, I want to thank you again because
thank
we know
you,
you're
Wayne.
A busy man, and thanks a lot for coming by and seeing us at the dance party and saying hello to all your friends here in Memphis and the Mid-South. And anytime you're in town and want to come by, we certainly will welcome you.
Well, thank you very much, Wink, and I'll see you again.
Okay, thanks a lot. Elvis Presley.
Let's talk about your move to Hollywood. That must have been quite a step up from Memphis, Tennessee to Hollywood, California.
Yeah, I went to my boss one day, Bill Grumbles, out on Madison Avenue, WHBQ Television. I walked into his office and I said, Mr. Grumbles, I've been here for almost 8 years and I'd like to try to spread my wings. I was out of college and I think I'd just about gone as far as I could in Memphis. I was doing pretty well and I said, could I be transferred to one of the other RKO stations? RKO owned the chain then. And he said, where would you like to go? Would you like to go to Los Angeles, Hollywood? That sounded good. Or would you like to go to New York, to WOR? We had KHJ in LA, WOR in New York. And I thought, palm trees are not too bad. Malibu sounds good. I said, let's try Hollywood. So he picked up the phone, called Norm Boggs, who ran KHJ television. So I got a young man in my office, blah, blah, blah. I won't go into detail, but he accepted the call and gave me a job. And within a month, I was on the plane going to Los Angeles. And they had a big party for me down at the fairgrounds. Gene Roper was the host, going away party. It was one of the most fabulous nights of my life, where all the kids were invited, you know, all the dance party people. Everybody who knew me from Memphis Television were invited for this free party at the fairgrounds. And it was just great. You had a band and all, and it was a big going away party. And I'll never forget flying into LA that first night with my program director at WHBQ Radio, Mark Forrester, who had given me my show Mars Patrol. And if you've ever flown into LA at night, you go for miles and miles of lights. And it really scared the dickens out of me because I thought, what have I done? I said, I was doing okay in Memphis, and I had a job, and I've got a job here, but can I maintain that? I'm a country boy going to the city. And it just really kind of scared me, kind of frightened me. And things worked out, and I've never been without a job. And I was there at KHJ, radio and television, doing my radio and TV. And then later I was top morning personality at KFWB, the top rock station there. But it was 1965 when I became enamored with game shows because I became addicted to a show that Alan Ludden did on CBS Every Day called Password. Loved the show. So simple, yet so compelling. And so I'd rush home after my radio show just to watch Password. And I checked into that, and I thought, that's not a bad way to make a living, because I found out that Alan Ludden would go in 2 days a week, tape, like we did game shows, tape five shows one day, five shows the next, and the other 5 days he'd play golf. I said, now there's got to be a worse way to make a living. So I went to my agent and I said, how about sending me on a game show hosting interview? And he did that. I didn't get the first one I went on, but about the third one was for a show called What's This Song at NBC, and I got it. And they knocked the K off my name for that first show because they thought Wink was too juvenile sounding. So for the first year on my first network game show, it was Win Martindale, Win with Win. And it was a sort of a music show, kind of like Name That Tune. It only lasted a year, but I got to work with celebrities and it honed my ad-libbing skills, and it was just a real good experience for me. And after that, I just went, I never could hold a job. I've done 19 game shows. I mean, either everybody wanted me or I couldn't hold a job. I'll leave that up to you. Only Bill Cullen, the great Bill Cullen, my idol as a game show host, hosted more shows than me. He did 21. I did 19. But
did you have a favorite?
That show got me started in the game show business, and my favorite of all was the one that most people know me by in the world of game shows, which was Tic Tac Dough. I did that for almost 10 years. And I remember here in Memphis was one of the great markets that we had. WMC carried it every night at 6:30 until Wheel of Fortune came along, and all of a sudden we weren't on the air anymore. It was kind of sad. And from that, I went on to some other shows, totaling 19, and it's been a great career for me. And I enjoy playing games.
Any closing thoughts?
Closing thoughts, I feel so privileged, and I feel so lucky and so honored to have had the opportunity to be a small part of this business and to have made a little impact on people's lives, whatever that impact might have been, good, bad, or indifferent. Hopefully it's more good than bad.
Well, this has been a pleasure having a conversation with Wink Martindale. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you. It's my pleasure. Thank you, Bonnie.
Funding for A Conversation with Wink Martindale was provided by
Mid-America Apartment Communities, an apartment-only real estate investment trust serving the Southeast and South Central United States. On the web at maac.net. Mid-America Apartment Communities, creating great places to live.
And by the WKNO Partners in Excellence Fund, committed to presenting quality programming. And also by members like you. Thank you.